In this lecture segment, we want to focus on the concept of a model as a useful tool for understanding and developing software. Okay, let's get started. Before we get too far, let's pause and consider why we really care about computers in the first place. What it really boils down to is that computers are a pervasive, critical, necessary part of our 21st century lives. Here's a short list of areas in which computers are absolutely pervasive. Science, technology, education, finance, and the list goes on and on. It's difficult to conceive of any area which does not heavily involve the use of computers nowadays. But yet, despite their importance to our modern-day way of life, computers actually do have some fundamental limits. Even though they are blindingly fast, in some sense, hard as it may be for us to think of it this way, computers really are kind of stupid. They can only do what they've been instructed to do, no more, no less. They can only execute the specific subset of instructions that their microprocessors allow. And finally, the only two things they understand are ones and zeros. Getting a computer to do something based on specific instructions expressed as ones and zeros is programming. But to this point, we really haven't defined that fundamental term. So let's take a whack at it. We'll talk about some specific definitions of programming a little later on, but here's one I like and that is enough to get us started for now. Programming is the science or art of describing, in very specific terms, what you want done in such terms that the computer itself can understand and execute those instructions. To some degree, to do this effectively, we have to have some working knowledge of the computer on its own terms. So at this point, we want to consider two ways of better understanding the heart of any computer: models and numbers. Okay, so just what is a model? Well, a model is a simplification or a generalization of some real-world situation. Models allow us to get some overall big-picture understanding of some real system without getting too buried in all the details just yet. Models are often expressed visually because, as the saying goes, a picture is often worth a thousand words. With a model, we're making a trade-off between lots of detail versus a better big-picture understanding of some system under consideration. As Albert Einstein once supposedly said, "Everything should be made as simple as possible, but no simpler." This picture shows a good example of a model. This is something I found on a NASA website while Googling around. It very nicely depicts the four major forces acting on any type of aircraft, and it shows them as two pairs of opposing forces. You have the lift opposing the weight, and the thrust opposing the drag. If the lift exceeds the weight, the airplane stays in the air. If the thrust exceeds the drag, the airplane moves forward. Very simple, but accurate. Now, no real aircraft is truly as simple as this, and there is actually lots and lots of underlying detail that goes into computing each one of these net forces. But as the starting point for understanding how an airplane works, you really can't do any better than this. If you were to study aircraft dynamics in any aeronautical engineering course, I can guarantee that you'll start off with some diagram that resembles this one. This is what a model does. It throws away lots of details and simplifies some real system to where we can make a start at understanding it. If this idea of models sounds interesting, lots of real-world disciplines are filled with them. If you've ever drawn a free body diagram or a circuit diagram in some engineering or physics class, you've made use of a model. Meteorologists use atmospheric models to help predict what the weather is going to be like tomorrow or a week from now. Policymakers use economic models to predict the effects on the economy from a tax increase or a bump in unemployment, and so on and so on. If you're interested, you can take a look at the indicated URL for many more examples of real-world models. This URL is also posted in this week's Canvas module. Now, modeling is actually a huge subject in and of itself, but for us in this course, there are a small handful of computing models which are of particular interest in the study of programming. We'll be seeing some of these over and over again this semester, and hopefully you encountered some of these already in CS10. These models are the standard computer model, the layered computer model, the memory model, the black box model, and the UML class model. You may see these going by different titles in other sources, but we will use these terms for this course. Let's have a look at each of these. Here's one depiction of a standard computer model. This is the same diagram that you'll find in your textbook. Now note that there is no one standard depiction of this information. There are many other variations out there. For example, take a look at the web links in this week's Canvas module for numerous other depictions of some standard computer architectures. However, this model shows one idealized depiction of the innards of some imaginary desktop computer. It shows that internal to the computer are its CPU and some memory, various controllers, and these are all interconnected by some data and instruction bus. There might be various input and output devices, accessed through ports, such as a mouse or keyboard, or perhaps today a touchscreen. There might be some output devices, such as a monitor or speakers. And of course, it's pretty much a given that usually there's some sort of network connection. Of course, no real computer looks exactly like this, but again, this model is a good starting point for grasping the main elements of some generic computer. And on this next slide, we see a list of some typical computer hardware, such as a CPU, data storage, main memory, various devices, and so forth. We really won't be too much interested in this model, but it's just presented here as useful background material and for the sake of completeness.